Joining us now to analyze today's headlines is Rahul Mahajan. He's a sociologist and author of Full Spectrum Dominance, U.S. Power in Iraq and Beyond. Hi, Rahul.
Hi, Sonali.
Well, a number of people were being held hostage in a chocolate shop in Sydney, Australia, since last night. With little real information to go on, all that is known is that a black flag with white Arabic writing was held up in the shop window by hostages, suggesting the action had a political goal, possibly related to the Islamic State. Media have released the name of an Iranian-born person they believe to be the armed gunman keeping people hostage, man Haroun Moniz. Meanwhile, on the other side of the world, another situation also involving guns is unfolding. A man believed to be a military veteran early this morning killed at least five people in three separate incidents in Montgomery County, Pennsylvania. He is still at large. Rahul, it's interesting to see how different the media coverage of these two separate incidents involving guns is. One so much more high profile than the other, with the word terrorist already appearing in connection to it. I know both stories are in the very early stages of unfolding, and we're seeing right now that the cafe in Sydney was just stormed by police and hostages released. But do you have any thoughts on how we as a society view these two types of incidents?
Well, I don't know what to make of the Pennsylvania incident yet, what category to put it in, but if we were to assume that it's like one of the many that we've seen that is motivated in some way by extreme right-wing ideology, then, I think both of these incidents would then be in a category that, I find quite terrifying. I think that both the sort of the general kinds of actions that are being done by people in Western countries in response to the existence of ISIS and its propaganda, and those that are happening primarily in the United States in response to the propaganda of the extreme right wing, are extremely dangerous as trends. And if anything, it would be that second category that seems to be, more likely a source of incidents in the United States. But as I said, it's really too early to tell what's going on in Pennsylvania.
And we'll certainly follow up on these stories in the coming days. The United Nations' latest climate summit in Peru, Lima, has just wrapped up. And as expected, the news is grim. Delegates to the COP20 climate talks were charged with laying the groundwork for a summit in Paris next year. But the agreement they came to was so weak that climate justice activists are calling it a, quote, roadmap to global burning. One environmentalist complained that it is taking us backwards, while another declared that it has set the Earth for an average warming of 3 to 4 degrees Celsius. Scientists have estimated that the planet can take no more than a 2-degree warming to stave off catastrophic impacts. Now, Rahul, some people hope that the announced U.S.-China agreement to lower emissions and a U.S. pledge to fund the Green Climate Fund in the days leading up to the conference meant that the Lima negotiations might yield better results this time around. Are you surprised at all?
I'm not, actually. The thing that surprised me was the U.S.-China agreement in the first place. And what would surprise me even more is if the two countries actually live up to the commitments they made in that agreement. At this point, I really have stopped expecting to see any progress made at international summits about the climate. So, yes, I mean, let's just remember that what's put us on the track to 3, 4 or more degrees of warming is the industrial economy we've created and the lack of will of any politicians to do anything about it, not so much just the failures of this or that conference.
And finally, thousands of people marched in Washington, D.C. on Saturday, demanding an end to police violence aimed at communities of color. The march, headed by Al Sharpton's National Action Network, included a rally featuring the parents of Eric Garner, Michael Brown, John Crawford III, Tamir Rice, and Amadou Diallo, among others. None of the anti-police brutality youth activists who have been tirelessly organizing in Ferguson, Missouri, were asked to speak on stage, however, leading to a small group to briefly commandeer the microphone. On the same day as the march, St. Louis County Prosecutor Robert McCulloch quietly released a third trove of grand jury evidence related to the shooting death of Michael Brown. The documents, which McCulloch says were, quote, inadvertently kept from the public in the initial release, included audio of the gunshots and testimony from Dorian Johnson, Brown's companion during the incident. Rahul, what do you make of this sort of ongoing clash between authorities who seem bent on protecting police and this new movement that seems to have emerged?
Well, the Memphis garbage workers strike that was Martin Luther King's last stop, last activist stop, as it were, has gone down in history in part because of, if you see footage from it, the people on strike are carrying signs that say, "I am a man." And that resonates because, of course, it was a protest against a system that denied the humanity of black men and black women, of course, and denied their equality. Right now, I think we've got slogans like Black Lives Matter and, of course, the proliferating I Can't Breathe are going to be, for this generation, what I Am a Man was for a previous generation. I think that there will be ebbs and flows of the protest against police brutality and impunity, but it's not going to go away.
Rahul, thanks so much as always for joining us. We'll talk to you next week.
See you then.
Rahul Mahajan is our daily Newsflash guest expert. He's a sociologist and author of Full Spectrum Dominance, U.S. Power in Iraq and Beyond. This is Uprising. We'll be right back in studio with Juan Cole. Stay tuned.